I am going to recall events from the past that elevated doping in sport to the next level, not only in cycling. The people from this story changed the sport forever, and the long-term consequences of their activity can be found even today. Let's go back to the year 1974. Manfred Ewald, the East German sports minister, launches a highly centralized doping program with the goal to produce Olympic champions. He is going to turn a nation of 17 million people into a power capable of competing on equal terms with the United States and the Soviet Union. The Plan 1425 is a secret state research project which demands the collaboration of sport physicians, talented scientists and coaching experts under the watchful eye of the GDR's Ministry of State Security, Stasi. Other countries from Eastern Bloc have their own doping programs. Don't make a mistake about it. But their scale cannot be compared to what was happening in Eastern Germany in the mid-70s. The system works by identifying potential stars in early age and training them in specialist academies. It's fueled by drugs and, most shockingly, based on blueprints designed by the Nazis. Dr. Manfred Heppner, who is the real orchestrator and brain of this system, is responsible for delivering performance-enhancing drugs to sport federations all over the country. The program impacts young, promising athletes who are often sworn to secrecy. They are not informed and even deceived about the drugs they are taking. All of them are put into a tough, advanced training regimen. Turinabol is the most common androgenic anabolic steroid taken orally in the form of blue pills. But the side effects of turinabol are far more dangerous than injections of this drug. However, doping in East Germany was not restricted to simple anabolic steroids. Junior athletes, for instance, were treated with androgenic hormones, HCG or clomiphene, which stimulates endogenous testosterone synthesis. Most of the research work had been performed in Saxony at the Institute for Physical Culture and Sports in Leipzig and at the Central Doping Laboratory in Croatia near Dresden. All invented drugs were produced by the state-run pharmaceutical company Genapharm. Then the steroids and other substances were delivered to sports organizations. Everything was controlled by the central office in Berlin, where also medical records of doped athletes were kept. Uwe Trommer, track cyclist, doped from the age of 16 to 23. He said the drugs were administered to cyclists in various ways. In certain training camps, these pills were just lying there openly on plates together with various other pills. And there were also amongst them sweets. Pieces of chocolates that were given only to us. Sweets specifically for sports people. And then there were so-called cocktails, which were injected. In the years since, Trommer has suffered from high blood pressure, damaged joints, kidney failure, and a decade ago he had a stroke. All of which, he says, are the result of his aerial doping and tough training regimen. Investigations after 1990 revealed that more than 400 doctors, trainers and officials were involved in State Plan 1425. It's estimated that the number of athletes affected is around 10,000. Was it effective? Hell yes. It became more obvious when looking at the Olympic Games medal classification from Montreal in 1976. Soviet Union, 125 medals. United States, 94 medals. East Germany, 90 medals. Those numbers prove that performance-enhancing drugs are a great equalizer for smaller nations who under clean circumstances wouldn't have been able to compete. I would say the East Germany was not a real nation, rather a separated artificial product of policy imposed by the Soviet Union. The leaders of this country were under pressure to build kind of new identity, and the sport was recognized as the perfect tool to achieve this goal. But let's go back to East German cycling. A vast number of specialists and members of medical staff involved in doping practices didn't vanish after the big fall of the Berlin Wall. They remained in local clubs or just diffused to other organizations who certainly benefit from their know-how. For instance, Mr. Heinz Löbl, Trommer's team doctor. In 2008, he was still in charge of the U23 Bundesliga race, Erzgebirgsrundfahrt, for the BDR as a race doctor. Ironically, the other specialists, Roland Müller, had the role of anti-doping control doctor in this race. According to the Mainz report, Roland Müller was in charge of doping allocation practice throughout cycling in the GDR and was also an unofficial Stasi employee, alias Egon Mithe. Many riders from the GDR era were riding for commercial teams after the transformation. Even though most of them were never accused of doping, it's hard to believe they didn't abuse performance-enhancing drugs. It's easy to recognize anabolic effects of steroids just by looking at the old pictures. They are still glowing. Well-pumped bodies with amazing lean muscle mass. This is how Ray Goldkin, former president of the Australian Cycling Federation, recalls short conversation with Michael Hübner. My very good friend, Michael Hübner, was one of the greatest sprinters and athletes I think I have seen dragged full of rubbish. Mike is still a very good friend, but I saw him a couple years ago. I said, "Michael, you look fantastic." He was half of the size, but still a fine-looking man. And he said, "This is my natural way." Present in East German cycling long before launching the state program from 1974. Clear evidence can be found in declassified Ministry of State Security files like this report from 1962, where the situation before the upcoming peace race had been discussed. The informant is responsible for cycling at sport club Dynamo Berlin. He puts everything into his work and has developed medical analysis on all the riders. The two of them are currently working together on establishing which medical substances might enable the athletes to achieve higher performance. Advanced courses of treatment have been already discussed. In the early 60s, substances like amphetamine and simple steroids became commonly used not only in Eastern Bloc. Also, first tests against these drugs were introduced at the Olympic Games. This is why, aware of this fact, GDR leaders wanted to standardize doping practices and at the same time make them invisible. The part of the Plan 1425 was focused on scientific research. Its German scientists invented a bridging drug for their athletes to use while scaling off steroids before facing testing. Androstenedione, the same hormone, was used decades later by baseball slugger Mark McGwire. German specialists developed more strategies in order to circumvent the doping controls. Since 1983, Genapharm had produced the epitestosterone propionate, a biologically inactive compound that had no commercial value but was prepared exclusively for the governmental doping system. The method assumed injections of epitestosterone along with testosterone, so the ratio in urine samples remained at normal level. There is evidence that similar cheating practices were used years later, wherever some ex-GDR coach was involved. As you can see in some way, Manfred Ewald's legacy remains one of the triumphs to this day. And one more thing. Being a top amateur cyclist in Eastern Bloc was totally different from riding on the West. Those people, often national heroes, were riding under big pressure and permanent supervision of KGB, Stasi or SB. They had to accept literally everything to continue careers, and performance-enhancing drugs were not the worst thing they could experience. I highly recommend reading the book of Herbie Sykes, The Race Against the Stasi, which covers history of one brave man, Dieter Wiedemann, who escaped and managed to ride the Tour de France. He also was there when Britain's Tommy Simpson rode himself to death on Mont Ventoux. But this is a different story.